Hachette Audio presents The Language Game: How Improvisation Created Language and Changed the World. Written by Morten H. Christiansen and Nick Chater. Read by Peter Noble. Be sure to look for your bonus PDF of the figures referenced in the audio. To our families. Preface: The accidental invention that changed the world. Language is essential to what it means to be human, yet we rarely give it a second thought. We discover just how central it is to every aspect of our lives only when it fails us, whether in a foreign city or following a stroke. Imagine the cataclysmic impact of a mystery virus that deprives us of language. Modern civilization would rapidly give way to anarchy. Citizens would be lost in an informational vacuum, unable to coordinate, bargain, or reason with each other. Or consider an evolutionary scenario in which our ancestors never developed language. Without the ability to easily transmit information and skills from person to person, to share ideas, form plans, or make promises, it is hard to imagine we could have developed the cultural and technological sophistication of contemporary hunter-gatherers, let alone more complex societies. Having a large human-like brain is not enough. We need look no further than our nearest primate cousins, the bonobos, chimpanzees, gorillas, and orangutans, for an idea of how limited our society would be without language. The gulf between ape communities and human society in the areas of culture and technology may not result only from language, but as we will hear, the human invention of language is probably the key factor from which most of the other differences flow. Even though language is deeply rooted in everything we do, it is profoundly puzzling. How can mere noises or gestures convey meaning at all? What are the patterns in the sounds, words, and meanings of which language is composed, and where do they come from? Why is understanding how a language works such an immense challenge for armies of professional language scientists when each new generation of children can easily master their native tongue by the age of 4? What is it about the human brain that makes language possible? Why don't we all speak the same language? Why can't chimps talk? Can machines understand language? Progress toward answering these and many other questions has been blocked by the fundamental misconception that the rough and tumble of everyday language is a pale shadow of an ideal language, where words have clear meanings and are put together following well-defined grammatical rules. But this traditional story has things exactly backward. Real languages are not slightly mangled variants of a purer, more orderly linguistic system. Instead, actual language is always a matter of improvisation, of finding an effective way to meet the communicative demands of the moment. Humans are playful, metaphorical, creative communicators whose words only gradually come to have more stable meanings. And the relatively stable regularities of grammar are not the starting point. They are the result of countless generations of communicative interaction through which linguistic patterns become ever more entrenched. We shall hear that the apparent impurity, disorder, and ill-discipline of contemporary speech does not represent a ragged instantiation of some perfect ideal. Instead, the bricolage of language, its bafflingly complex interacting and overlapping patterns, is a product of its history. The myriads of conversations that have incrementally and inadvertently created today's sophisticated linguistic systems. The spontaneous emergence of linguistic order is a story as remarkable as the emergence of life itself. Language, we suggest, is like a game of charades, a limitless collection of loosely connected games, each shaped by the demands of the situation and the shared history of the players. Like charades, language is continually invented in the moment and reinvented each time we play again. Ludwig Wittgenstein, arguably the most influential philosopher of the 20th century, saw meaning as arising from how we use language in communicative games. A cry of hammer could be an instruction to start hammering or to pass a hammer. It might be a warning that a hammer is falling from a nearby roof, a reminder to buy a hammer, or not to forget to bring one, and so on. The possibilities are limited only by our imagination. What counts as a hammer or hammering will depend on which language game we happen to be playing. When putting up a tent, a hammer can be a mallet or a convenient stone. If we're demolishing a house, a sledgehammer is a good hammer. But if we want to carefully shape metal jewelry, we'd want a delicate chasing hammer instead. For Wittgenstein, it makes no sense to ask what hammer means, independent of its use in a particular communicative game. The meaning of a word comes from how we use it in conversation. From this perspective, learning a language is like learning to be part of a series of endless community-wide games of charades, where each new game builds on those that have gone before. Each new generation of language learners is not starting from scratch, but joining a tradition of linguistic games that have been in progress from before anyone can remember. To join in the game, the child or the second language learning adult needs to jump into a linguistic game and start playing. This is how they gradually master specific communicative challenges, one by one. Learning a language is learning to become a skillful charades player. To successfully play language games, we need to be adept at dealing with the back and forth of everyday human interactions. We don't need to learn an abstract system of grammatical patterns. We talk without knowing the rules of our language, just as we play tennis without knowing the laws of physics, or sing without knowing music theory. In this very real sense, we speak and do so skillfully and effectively without knowing our language at all. In this audiobook, we outline a revolutionary perspective that overhauls almost everything we thought we knew about language. We shall hear how the game of charades, where linguistic communication is banned, paradoxically reveals deep insights into how language works. We'll explain how our brain is able to improvise linguistic moves at an astonishingly rapid rate, how we create meaning in the moment, and how the rich and complex patterns in language emerge from the accumulation of layers of past games, rather than from an innate genetic blueprint or language instinct. We'll hear how languages are in continual flux, how people without a common tongue can create language from scratch surprisingly rapidly, and why language has likely been independently reinvented countless times. Language games can develop in many directions, which has led to the amazing diversity of the languages across the world. And the creation of language is not only important in itself, it also changed the nature of evolution. It is what makes human culture possible, with its laws, religions, arts, sciences, economics, and politics. We'll find, too, that the improvised inventiveness of human language is why real, human-like communication is so incredibly difficult for artificial intelligence to mimic. This, in turn, has profound implications for whether computers will really be able to outsmart us in the near future. We'll argue that language is perhaps humanity's greatest accomplishment. Yet it is not a product of individual design or brilliant foresight. It is the result of a uniquely human ability to play successive, communicative games. In our daily interactions, all we ever aim to do is to construct a solution to the conversational challenge of the moment. But over time, systems of communication begin to emerge through multitudes of conversational encounters. Humanity's most important invention turns out to be unplanned, a side effect, a collective accident. This is an audiobook about how language emerges gradually, one communicative interaction at a time. And the ideas in this audiobook have themselves emerged gradually, one conversation at a time, in the 30 years that we, the authors, have been working together on language. The two of us met at the University of Edinburgh, where we received our PhDs at the Centre for Cognitive Science, now part of the School of Informatics. Our scepticism concerning the then dominant view of language as being governed by abstract mathematical principles that might be encoded in our genes was one of the many things that drew us together. We, like many others, wanted to explore ways in which the rule-like nature of language might arise as a side effect of more fundamental principles. Many memorable conversations have followed, such as the fascinating discussion we had with philosopher Andy Clark at a bar where Nick, looking potentially underage and having left his passport in the car, couldn't initially have a drink, that ranged from why scissors fit our hands and why popular tunes are so easy to sing, to how language has evolved. Another time, when we took a memorable post-conference stroll in Vancouver's Stanley Park, with the sun sparkling on the ocean, we realized that the complex interlocking patterns in language may be the product of construction, like building the Eiffel Tower using different kinds of Lego blocks, rather than of reduction, like chiseling it from a single block of raw marble. A change of viewpoint that completely shifted our understanding of how languages are learned and how they change. Later, we started to see.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.